two-factor authentication.
Autofills the login.
Too many passwords for all your different systems.
So how many passwords do you know off the top of your head? To tell you the truth, I couldn't even tell you what my Netflix password is. From banking accounts to online games and even the hair salon, it's estimated that the average person has 100 passwords. It'd be nice if the world didn't need passwords. And that future might come to fruition soon, especially with the advent of the password manager. I mean, there's a plethora of options, whether it's LastPass, Dashlane, Bitwarden. I'm sure you'll let me know which one's best in the comments down below. But to me, one company seems to stick out.
It's called 1Password.
1Password.
The 1Password app.
1Password is a juggernaut in the password management space, being one of Canada's most valuable tech firms at $6.8 billion as of 2022. 1Password has all of the resources at its disposal to take over the entire market. But are they ready for a passwordless future? The winner in this space is going to be the company that best balances security with convenience. And we're going to walk through the origins of the password space, 1Password's rise as a certified SaaS legend, and finally, we'll talk about if our future truly is passwordless. I'm Ben Hillman, and this is Verticals. A password is defined as something that enables one to pass or gain admission, such as a sequence of characters required for access to a computer system. Early uses included ciphers, wax seals, and mask letters in order to protect information. American Prohibition saw the rise of speakeasy bars where alcohol was distributed illegally. Patrons who obtained a card or phrase could offer the password in order to get inside and imbibe to their heart's content. But perhaps no person is more important to the modern use of passwords than the American computer scientist known as Fernando J. Corbato.
Dr. Corbato, maybe you can put this whole business in perspective for us.
While at MIT in the 1960s, Corbato and other researchers built a time-sharing computer called Compatible Time-Sharing System, or CTSS. CTSS is responsible for many foundational tools that tech and SaaS folks use today, like email, instant messaging, and file sharing. The issue to be solved for CTSS was that there were multiple terminals used by multiple people who all had their own set of files. At the time, there were methods like knowledge-based authentication, information only the user would know, like, what is your mother's maiden name? But this would require the computer to store personal information, which users may not want to share.
I like to see that.
So instead, users were assigned a username and a password. The one fatal flaw that Corbato himself has admitted is security was not put at a premium. This gave way to careless hacks and break-ins, like one user requesting files be printed offline, which meant they could simply reveal all the passwords and log in as their colleagues. Probably could have used a password manager back then. While this didn't result in a major security breach, it is indicative of one of the core issues with passwords themselves. It relies on an individual's memory, but also not accidentally giving up their secret code, whether it's written down or in a phishing attack, otherwise known as a fraudulent practice used to reveal personal information. In order to win in this space, the companies that would arise would have to focus on ensuring password managers were secure. Today, all password managers must use high-level encryption standards, meaning all your information is converted into secret code. Security is important, but in the early days, it wasn't really the number one priority. Convenience was key. In 2000, Cyber Systems released their flagship product, RoboForm.
And you just click fill form.
Look at that. Whoa!
RoboForm first started out as an automatic form filler, but soon after implementation, the founders realized that users were typically using their product to fill out a very specific form. Passwords. This provoked them to go all in on the space, and just like that, the password manager race was off. Dave Tier and Rustam Karimov got into the game shortly thereafter. In 2005, the two founded AgileBits, a company which helped folks build websites. While doing this, they realized how difficult it was to keep up with passwords. On May 19th, 2006, they uploaded the first ever version of 1Password for Mac. Shortly after launch, users started sending feedback. Tier and Karimov couldn't have been more excited. They regularly pushed out new versions of 1Password with bug fixes and additional features, which resulted in more downloads and even more feedback. They took that information and refined the tool further and further, releasing 1Password for iOS and Windows in 2010. There's perhaps no better indicator of 1Password's success than the fact that for the first 14 years of existence, they were entirely customer funded. In order to accelerate growth, 1Password finally decided to raise $200 million in 2019 and another $100 million in 2021. This took the company's valuation to $2 billion. With 90,000 paying customers and $120 million in annual recurring revenue, the sky was the limit for 1Password. And they didn't stop there. In 2022, they closed another round of funding that brought in $620 million. Investors included superstars like Robert Downey Jr., Scarlett Johansson, and Ryan Reynolds.
Okay, well, how many of you have downloaded 1Password?
Their valuation was pumped to $6.8 billion. The reason 1Password has found so much success comes down to its mission to ease the tension between security and convenience. Over the past year alone, the platform has launched a secure way to transfer items within 1Password, Events API, a way to give security and IT teams greater visibility, and 1Password for Safari. But perhaps no greater element to 1Password's success is its focus on customer satisfaction. Today, every employee at 1Password, including its directors, spends time each week answering customer support queries. The product team then takes a closer look at the results and they quantify it. Developers then make judgments and decisions based on that feedback. If the product and design teams need specific or pointed feedback, or if the problem is more pronounced, the company interviews people who use 1Password the most. An interesting wrinkle in all of this is that 1Password does not offer a freemium tier. Frequent viewers of the show know that pretty much every successful company we've discussed thus far has had a free offering. Competitor LastPass came under fire recently for downgrading their free offering. Users were forced into choosing if they could access LastPass on their mobile or their desktop device. Customers became so upset that in an Android Authority poll of over 8,000 users, 4 out of 5 folks said that they would move to a competitor. So wonder what competitor that might be. It's important to remember that freemium, while effective, is an acquisition channel, not a monetization strategy. 1Password wasn't suffering from restricted growth, so they didn't really need freemium. For more, you can check out our own research on the matter. Being close to customers, developing a powerful product, and remaining true to founding values are the ingredients that have contributed to 1Password's success. 1Password is well positioned to drive continued growth. The company said it plans to triple its engineering and customer support teams, build out the Events API functionality, and finance more acquisitions. Ultimately, 1Password will thrive as long as it dances that line between security and convenience. So let's talk a little bit more about that convenience, because this line is an important one to focus on. According to Ann Johnson, Corporate VP of Security at Microsoft,
the user and the password are the weakest link in your security system.
It's why certain protocols must be put in place that can sometimes result in a dip in convenience. You might already be familiar with two-factor authentication, but in simplistic terms, 2FA is an extra step used to verify if a user is who they say they are. This is done with a text code, an authenticator app, or verification in another app. 1Password employs this, and it's pretty much industry standard for all password managers. But while 2FA adds a layer of security, it also adds extra friction when logging in. So how does 1Password stay secure but eliminate these extra steps? Well, in June of 2022, CEO Jeff Shiner announced that 1Password had joined the FIDO Alliance. FIDO is essentially a consortium of leading tech companies, government agencies, and other industries that launched in 2013 with the goal of eliminating the use of passwords on websites, devices, and apps. Users can already use their fingerprint to unlock 1Password on their computer or Face ID to unlock 1Password on their mobile device. Additionally, 1Password has formed strategic partnerships with folks like Yubico, where you can insert a YubiKey, or a USB device, that you then touch to complete 2FA. Other password managers have followed suit, and with this trend, maybe the future is passwordless after all. I want you to picture a world where you don't have to rack your brain in order to log into any account. Imagine if you didn't even have to remember one. All you do is touch a finger pad here or look into an eye scanner there. Some banks have even started using voice recognition software. But there's a lot of ground to make up. According to Bitwarden, over half of 2,000 consumers surveyed said they relied on their memory to manage passwords. A third said they still use pen and paper. It's more important for SaaS companies to ensure password security is top of the line, especially considering how detrimental a customer data leak can be. Ultimately, any company that wishes to topple 1Password has to be adequately prepared for a passwordless future. Which company do you think that'll be? Let us know what you think in the comments down below. From Paddle, I'm Ben Hillman, and I think the future might be passwordless.